this podcast, Dan DiGrazia from IBM talks about the intersection of chief data scientist and open source. So stay tuned. So welcome everyone to Future of Data Podcast. Today we have with us Dan DiGrazia. He's a chief data scientist at IBM in open source, and we'll talk about it. And a brief bio before we get going. So Dan has almost 30 years of experience working with large data sets, starting with the unusual work of analyzing potential jury pools in 1980s. Dan also did some of the first PC-based voter registration analytics in the Chicago area, including putting the first complete list of registered voters on a PC. Wow. Interested in almost anything new and technical, he worked at Chicago Board of Trade, where he taught himself basic to write algorithms while working as an arbitrator in financial futures. After the military, Dan moved to San Francisco, where he worked several small companies and startups, designing and implementing some of the first PC-based fax systems and enterprise accounting software, and working with early middleware connections using the early 3GL and 4GL languages. Always pursuing the technical edge cases, Dan worked into InfoBridge, a column store database startup in the US and EMEA, at Lingotech, and InQtel funded company working in large dataset translations and big data analytics companies like Datamere, and his current position as chief data scientist for open source and IBM channel organizations. Dan's current just for fun project is working to create an app that will record and analyze bird songs and provide the user with information on the bird and the specifics of the current songs. Wow. That's fascinating bio, Dan. I do appreciate sharing that.
Thank you. It's been kind of fun to hear it like that. I've been busy.
Yes, you have been busy. So yes, so why don't you just walk us through journey? I don't know how much justice I did to your background. If you can walk us, walk our listeners and viewers through your journey over this and fun stuff, and walking us what all really this all means. That'd be fascinating.
Well, you know, I guess I best describe my current journey, or my journey to my, you know, current role, position, place, and where I am as a zigzag. I started this. I guess the best way to do this is, you really start at the beginning for people. Something inspired them to work in computers, or something like that. You know, something they said, this is what I want to do, and for me, actually, at 17, I saw my first computer. It was one of my brother's. It was an Apple IIe, and I remember looking at it and thinking, I don't know what I want to do, but it's not going to have anything to do with that. It wasn't interesting to me at all. And it was about 4 years later, 3-4 years later, working at the Board of Trade, as you talked about, I was doing arbitrage there, which is, you know, working in the cash markets and the futures side. And it was all about getting to the bar. I mean, really, if you think about, you know, need-based learning, all my friends would be done by 3 o'clock, and they were done for the day. They were on. And my job was to sit and listen, you know, to either recordings of some of the trades. But I sat there and I basically wrote algorithms, or took algorithms that we knew of and mashed them together. And that work took me a couple of hours on a calculator. And I was sitting in front of a TRS-80 that happened to have two drives. Actually, Zenith had bought them already. So I was looking at that, and I asked my boss, and he said, well, nobody knows how to use it. And so I grabbed, luckily back then they bundled BASIC with DOS. And so I had a language to learn and an operating system. So I pulled it out of its, you know, effectively a Quotron mode. You know, it was simply a dumb terminal, and started coding. And you know, that at that point, it went from the faster I get this done, I'm going to get to the bar, to this is actually interesting. You know, it was the first feeling of I could make these things do something. You know, I could, something like that could happen. And that got, that really got me started in development. And from there, well, I had some time in the military, which was, although a lot of fun, did not leave me with anything in the way of much added computer skills, but it was great life experience. So I went back and started working basically as a, for hire consultant. I was a little ahead of the game. And because I was fascinated, I took a hold of the first copies of, Symphony, I think it was called, which was, an actual integrated, word processor, database kinds of things. It had a spreadsheet. And that took me into understanding NetWare and networking. And, from that point, I met my wife in San Francisco, and it's funny, she really didn't understand computers. I mean, not a lot of us, to be fair, understood desktops, PCs, whatnot back then. So she asked if I would mind moving to California, to, Northern California, to be exact, because she wasn't ready to move back to Chicago. And I said, that's sort of like asking a priest if he wants to, go to the Vatican for a little while. I was like, yeah, I think I can find something interesting to do. And you mentioned some of the things I was doing back then. It was just, it was a great time. This was, really pre the web being a, an average ubiquitous thing. So, we used modems when we wanted to connect. 9600 baud was an amazing speed. It was blazing fast. But all through all of this, to sort of tie it up, I went from place to place, but it always came down to I was fascinated with the data they were working on. That always generated for me the biggest questions. Why is it saying what it's saying? Why do I think it's saying what it's saying? Just early questions. Data scientist wasn't a thing. In fact, although we were doing algorithms, nobody really called them that at the time. That wasn't what we were doing. And I think that the best thing that, for me was I worked at small companies where you could take advantage of whatever technology they had. You had that opportunity to try something. And that gave me the opportunity at these small places to move forward and finally get moving back to Chicago and really then moving into, companies like InfoBright, working in column store databases, working at Datamere, things like that. And throughout that, particularly as I was leaving some of these smaller companies, open source became a real fascination for me. What had a person actually write code for free? I programmed myself. For fun, I would try things. I would do things like that, but I never, it never occurred for me that way. And so watching people start to write things in the beginning was really interesting. Getting involved with some of them, it was just fascinating. So I think that's probably the best part that brought me to, the perfect storm of enough data science and enough of everything else that they wanted for the role I was looking for at IBM, which is as evangelical as it is technical, working with partners.
Interesting. Thank you so much, by the way. I think that was really fascinating to hear your journey.
A long walk over 30 years.
I do appreciate that. So let's talk about your role in IBM. Like, what does really a chief data scientist of open source really mean?
It's a, I think anywhere, chief means you're a utility player, both horizontally and vertically. you have to be ready, particularly in data science, you know, to hack together code in the morning and then advocate for some strategic change later that same day. And horizontally, you need to be ready, certainly in open source and in the partner channel. You know, I'm a counselor, a speaker, a consultant for IBM partners, companies new to IBM every day. I guess if I might give a small shout out, a lot of this is evangelism, you know, social media work, things like that. And I'm really lucky enough to work with a guy named Alex Josephs, who runs a team called the IBM Wolfpack. And he's their leader, and they're really out there doing different things. And we share a boss, Vlad Stojanovsky. And the group really works with individuals and companies every day. And I get to, you know, whether it's analytics or blockchain, you know, ML, DL, all in the cloud. I'm really happy to be supporting them. And so that's really my role, is not the kind of average everyday data scientist, but more data scientist as advocate, I guess I would say.
Interesting. And I think one thing that I found really fascinating about your background is, I think we talked about your jury poll initiative, putting all the data into PC. These require a lot of grunt work, like a lot of sort of, it's laborious, with probably no plane of sight of when the incentive is going to come and all that. And many of the businesses that we talk to, who are either starting this journey, this is the biggest, it's more of a psychological plunge than the technology plunge, right? To really go and fix their data, understand the data and all that. Like, what are some of the motivations that you could share that has helped you, like, stay consistent through sort of creating such a laborious and such an important role and in sort of consolidating this data sources? We'll resume after a short break. This part of the podcast is brought to you by First Friday Fair, fastest AI-powered way to find your next opportunity. Check out the website firstfridayfair.tao.ai and find your next dream job. Let's get back to the podcast.
You know, I think, you know, for me personally, and we've talked before, and when you and I were talking about what makes teams, what makes companies, and yeah, you know, I'm probably going to say the word communication only about 800 times in this call, but I found that diversity of thought is a huge thing that's helped me, and diversity of background. You know, I realized as you were talking about some of the bits and pieces that you've taken from my background, I use those all the time. I use, you know, military thought, planning, experience, training, and I'm just as easy, like you said, to look at things I learned in jury selection. Mm. And I guess the interesting thing that I guess comes to mind from your question is what that all pulls together. What I really love about working with data is that in the end, we're usually trying to, or my favorites are when we're trying to answer questions or get answers to people who are working with people, you know, that's what gets me excited. So, you know, in jury selection, we're trying to understand the minds of people that haven't even made up their mind yet. Mm. You know, we're looking at a potential pool of jurors and saying, out of that pool of the people that come forward, how are they going to think about things? And why can we say that with confidence? And so I think that the same is true. I mean, customer churn, I guess the challenge with, you know, jury pools and, you know, voters and things like that is we can't ask them the questions we can in churn, you know, what products did you like? You know, why did you leave our company? What would have you come? We can't really ask those questions outright. So, trying to find algorithms, and data that helps us infer something with confidence is a lot of it. And I guess the only other part I'd add in, you know, how I tie this stuff together, because that's really what I want to do at the end. But the thing that really sold me, and I think it's probably, I imagine every developers have a version of this, data scientists, it's when I worked at the Board of Trade, I was doing, you know, intraday work. We're trying to figure out what's going to happen today and tomorrow. We're not looking at the mega trends. And to have your algorithms predictively work, pretty cool. You know, it's a, you know, at the end of the day, to see the market, you know, bounce off whatever you said, it's not going below this, you know, and they hit a ceiling and, you know, it bounce off of that. I think that's probably what, you know, cemented for me the technical side of it. You know, wow, math works, you know. I mean, in the end, this is a group of people making decisions about buying and selling and doing all of these things. And math works. So that sold me hard on looking at and understanding.
Interesting. And I think one other thing that I really found fascinating about your background is rarely have I seen, and obviously maybe I have not looked hard enough, chief data scientist and open source put together. So it I think that's it's a fascinating thought, because I think it puts sort of more emphasis on the cultural aspect of the usage of data. Like, what's your thought on that? Like, if I'm a business and I'm trying to figure out, do I need to focus on that as a chief scientist role? Like, what's your thought on that?
You know, it's interesting because, you know, as it pertains to my title initially, it was kind of a holdover from when I first started. People were working to figure out how to make money in open source. Right? So I came on board to support those efforts. And it was a kind of it's a scary place, as you say, for a business, particularly for a business partner at any of these companies. You know, I came up with a mantra that I used to say, which was, the path to profit in open source is the mixed stack deployment. Now, for people who've never been in the cloud, they kind of looked at me blankly, but I had their attention. And what I really wanted to say to them is, you know, it's not, open source is not about saving money. And unfortunately, people throw that, you know, as their first thing. Frankly, it is about, you know, much better transparency, much better security in many, many cases. And there are things that, whether you call it value add, enterprise grade, although people certainly argue open source can do that, there are times in that mixed stack where what you want to do is save $500,000 by using an open source data structure. And you remember several years ago, it was going to be Hadoop. I was never that sure of that, and I think we're seeing it it fade to, you know, other data stores. But the idea was you could save, you know, $500,000 by going to Hadoop. And it was, in data science, it was like, okay, great, but let's move that money to something that we can now use that we couldn't even think about, whether it's better analytics tools, whether it's better security, because we're actually, you know, some of this data will be public facing. So, you know, with so many subtleties, you know, across both, I mean, and I'm sure I'm out of date, the last time I looked, there were 297 open source actual projects on Apache. And about 100 of them said they had to do with data in one form or another, particularly big data, because that was the phrase the last time I looked still. You know, so I think we're seeing an interesting wave in there that people don't realize is a social wave as much as a, you know, as much as a technology wave. And in fact, I guess this is something, if I'm saying to, you know, companies, like, what can you be missing? If your developers are spending their free time developing things, then they're learning, they're doing things on their dime, and you need to figure out how to support them and enable them, because that, you know, is clearly something that makes them happy because they're doing it. And I think the more we do that, the better code we get across the board. So I really enjoy mixing the two things together.
Interesting. Wow. And I think that's a very, very sort of refreshing thought, by the way. I do appreciate sharing that. So from your vantage point, what is the state of open source when it comes to data? Like, what's your vantage point? What are you seeing?
We'll resume after a short break. This part of the podcast is brought to you by First Friday Fair, fastest AI-powered way to find your next opportunity. Check out the website firstfridayfair.tao.ai and find your next dream job. Let's get back to the podcast.
This is happening.
You know, I mentioned a little, you know, it's interesting to watch the evolution and revolution steps that happen to us in open source, the cycles. I mean, as we were just talking, 5 years ago, you know, the big focus of things was Hadoop. Gartner was predicting giant, you know, others, the Gartners of the world were predicting, you know, huge markets, data lakes built on Hadoop were important strategies. With, you know, the evolution of Spark, other in-memory processing, Hadoop sort of was relegated to cheap storage, and then current systems have made that even less desirable. They've become other solutions. And I think that really the state of open source when it comes to data today has moved towards almost more towards the I'm going to have 100 arguments against this by saying it, but towards the DevOps side, a lot of it, there's still a ton to be done in data science, and there's a ton to be learned out there. And, you know, we can talk about some of the things I think that are going to be happening, but historically, the shadow was the quality of the design work of the UX, UI, whatever you want to call it. What I usually see is situations where, you know, and people can argue with me all they want, but for every 100 developers you have working on a major open source project, you don't have 10% of them, solely as UI designers, really thinking about what is it that people want to do. And I think we're starting to see UIs come up, particularly in DevOps, because the UIs are now necessary for management consoles, for deployments of containers, you know, the whole, you know, Docker and Kubernetes and things like that, Red Hat's OpenShift. You know, large companies tend to bring a level of quality to open source UX that hasn't been there. So I think that the state of it is always, you know, growing and churning and fascinating. And right now, I think there are major moves to get all that data we've been figuring out how to compile and store and put on the web into production systems. So we're really seeing it much more on the DevOps side right now.
Interesting. And so if I'm a business and I'm trying to understand this open source projects and tools, how should I evaluate this market? Like, how should I say recruit a tool, or what are some of the thoughts and practices that you could share that would help me understand what to look for and how to recruit that?
We'll resume after a short break. This part of the podcast is brought to you by First Friday Fair, fastest AI-powered way to find your next opportunity. Check out the website firstfridayfair.tao.ai and find your next dream job. Let's get back to the podcast.
Well, I think it's if you, and this is sort of a, Claire, I'm having the focus of this, I guess, and is for the sake of simplicity, look at open source as a vendor. Because that allows you to steer away from trying to think of the big open source. Right? You know, who cares if there are 190 some odd projects that are actually actively going right now? think of them as a vendor, then you're going to think about, okay, what do I need? Am I looking for, you know, real-time streaming data? Will Kafka solve that? Will one of my favorites, what was it, Flink? Many people would have said, you know, Flink was a better tool. I think that, but if you go into it as, okay, I'm looking for X, what do all of the first and, you know, second tier, you know, enterprise value add companies have for me? And then what is the open source alternative? And the only thing is, you know, you can find on the web people who will talk to you about the top five benefits of open source that really aren't available, and look at those and decide if they're important to you. But put them in the RFP mix the same as everything else.
Interesting. And how much should I commit to open source as an organization? Like, what, how is it? Is it really? So what's your take on that? Like, how much I should be telling my folks to recruit?
You know, I think it's speaking as someone who's worked for several vendors, I hate vendor lock-in. I was also an IT director and an IT manager, so I guess I come from that side as well, you know, in the past. But since the larger vendors, and certainly, you know, IBM, Google have a huge investment in open source and making that work, and, you know, having people work on those projects. DataStax is Databricks, those guys all do. Your commitment to open source as a strategy, I guess, still has to make sense in part of a larger strategy. I think people fall down when they say we have an open source strategy. I'm more interested in somebody who says, well, we have a full stack strategy. You know, we're either going to be bare metal, or we're going to be fine with, you know, getting virtualized servers or private, you know, virtual servers, you know, all the way up to the top of our analytics, you know, reporting. If they say that's a strategy they're working on, then the analogy I use in training, I actually have stickers that I hand out. It's a picture of the game Jenga. Right, it's a Swahili word to build, right? And so I show them Jenga and say, well, you could take this piece out and you could actually replace it with open source. You can take this piece out and replace it with open source. Here are some things that I probably wouldn't replace with open source, you know, those sorts of things. And so in committing to the strategy, it's really first, what is your go to cloud strategy? I mean, even on-prem, obviously, open source is available. Right. Well, but look at it in terms first of, do I have a sound strategy of every layer of my stack? And then have those teams go out and look. You know, go, you know, have them, you know, see what's there. You know, I have, you know, personal opinions that are, you know, bound to piss people off on what does work and doesn't in the stack, you know, open source wise, or, you know, private label products, commercial products, whatever you'd like to call them. But in short, looking at open source as a strategy is too narrow of a focus. First, tell me you have a strategy for your stack.
Interesting. And if we see sort of the future of data as a whole, and then we see, we're looking at sort of open source market, so what is the role of, like, what do you see as from your vantage point, or some of your personal prediction, that how would the world pan out, or the future data would pan out, considering this open source? And sort of, I think and this is, we hear a lot from a lot of our interaction with the businesses, is there are a lot of options nowadays, and then the tools are not sticky anymore. Some areas, and some areas they're extremely sticky, but almost everything is going through transformation nowadays. So sure, I'm using something, but it's as you rightly said, that at one point Hadoop was the only thing that everyone was cramming about, but right now it has found its role at as a cheap storage somewhere. So what do you think is where we're heading to from whatever you're seeing?
I think that you're right. The risk you discussed there, and I think to talk about it, very specifically, there was a product. There was an open source system that was pronounced TEZ, T-E-Z. It's part of Hadoop. It was actually a Hindi word. It was TEZ, right? It meant fast. And TEZ, went up and pretty much died before people could even learn to pronounce it correctly. What they were saying. And I think that's the thing that strikes fear in people. And one of the things that is helping, I think, alleviate a lot of that fear is moving to smaller services. I mean, when software was monolithic, even open source was monolithic. Mm. And as the market moves to microservices, kinds of architectures where I'm calling this little bit to do this and this little bit to do that, I think that we'll see that happen as well, just like, as we talked, Kafka, Flink were sort of single use kinds of things. They got data from here to here and you could evaluate in the stream. So what I see happening in open source is the same thing. There'll be a move away from it. And there is much less risk in using open source because you actually can quite literally sit in on meetings that talk about, the transparency of it is phenomenal. And that allows you as, someone who's a CIO, CTO, to do some planning because you at least can have an opinion based on whatever's being said. You can buy into or not. When working with vendors, it's a much more difficult thing. That said, the deprecation of vendor-based products really goes for years. Ordinary effort to make sure that process is gradual and that people can move away from things that IBM is no longer going to be supporting. But it's still not as good, I think, as what we see in open source, where you literally can sit in on the development meeting and get the feel. Are these people excited? Are they leaning into it? Or is this, just kind of nobody's interested in working on it anymore sort of thing?
Interesting. Interesting. And from your vantage point, what are some of the interesting areas to focus on, or where some of the fun stuffs are happening when it comes to data?
The fun for me, is AI, and I guess if I talked about what do I think companies are, in fact, in this area, what do I think companies are missing, right? Because it's fun, and sometimes fun automatically equals it's not a business sort of thing. But for lack of a better phrase, I call it small AI or small cognitive assistance. Most companies, especially large companies, they're doing okay at implementing, big AI projects. But there's many places where small AI, we see this in the personal sector all the time. How many single-use apps do we have on our phone? How many, my favorite Save My Butt app is is a picture to PDF system. Right. Oftentimes in contracts, people want a PDF and they need it faxed and that sort of thing. And all I've got are the documents in my phone. Right. I'm on a plane and I can sit there. I think it's called it's TurboScan and TurboFax. I hope they do well with it. But to sign a contract and get it over to somebody where they'll accept that quickly, that single use sort of application, and it's spreading to AI. I don't see AI as a job coster. I never have, and I don't think in IBM we do. If you think about it, at one point we had computer departments like we had typing pools. You went there to get something done you couldn't do yourself, and then typewriters appeared on everybody's desk, and then those changed to computers. Now we carry them as phones. And companies that are trying to move small cognitive apps into their workforce are going to have an edge because these tools are designed to augment individual staff people. One of my favorite use cases, actually, I was just talking to a company in the Bay Area. They're called Coda. And what they're doing is they're using AI to evaluate contracts. Right. The idea there being that contracting is you know, nobody's worked anywhere where somebody hasn't said it's still in contracts. They're always overloaded. We're never going to lose those jobs, those lawyers, those contract specialists. But if they can have cognitive assistants that know how to churn through a contract and at a first glance say, hey, here's what's missing. Here's what's funny. The payment terms don't match our standard payment terms. You know, our classic paragraph 3B is missing. Those sorts of things. So I think the same thing we're going to see in translation. Google Translate's kind of humorous for people that actually try and use it on the road, but it's sure better than nothing. And the work I was doing at Lingotech, we're starting to translate mass amounts of data. And trying to do that reliably, I think, is really going to take AI. And so single use, small AI is where I think the most fun is. I mean, me and my bird call project. I think is where we're going to see companies gain the biggest edge and where I see the most fun.
Interesting. I think that's a very interesting thought. So basically the world is getting more appified, going like very use case centric. Interesting. So now that means maybe a massive cultural change, right? Because businesses are not built around apps. They're built, say, their apps are built around businesses. So now how do you, like as a data scientist, how would sort of you bring these two worlds together? Like I want to do my business the way it is. And now I think you're spot on that. Hey, what's your thoughts there?
Yeah, you know, I worked at an interesting startup that was bought by Oracle, and it was project and process management work. And I got a chance to really dig into, you know, getting my green belt a long time ago in Six Sigma and looking at process. And I think that if a company has a grip on its processes and can break them down into the discrete parts, that's where they're going to be able to see, this is where I could bring, you know, automation in the form of AI. So as a data scientist, and you know, it's a data science people, you know, often automatically go to large data sets. You know, and we used to talk about the three V's or four V's, you know, the velocity, you know, variety, volume, my favorite fourth, veracity, whether we trusted the data. You know, most companies will say, well, we don't have data that size. We don't have terabytes of data. We don't need a data scientist. And I absolutely disagree, right? The microservices, the kinds of things that people can put together. So if you look at your processes and anytime you have a situation where the process stops, well, some human looks at something or looks something up, you have an opportunity to make a difference with AI. If they're looking up something that's, you know, more than just a, you know, an index search, you know, they have to go look at a contract or they have to go look, the famous one with Watson at IBM is looking at things like x-rays for cancer. Right? What you want is somebody like Watson. They never get tired. They remember all 100 million x-rays they ever looked at. You know, that's the kind of thing that, where the idea of somebody being tired or grumpy or having a bad day results in something mismanaged. And the number of prescriptions that go through handwritten by doctors who, as we all joke, are proud of the fact that nobody can read their handwriting. stuff. Those are challenges for AI that are very discrete. Mm. You know, a prescription reading AI, you know, can't read a book, wouldn't understand, you know, contracts, but, you know, it can churn through, you know, these sorts of prescriptions. And with the more and more prescriptions being faxed into places, things like that, I mean, that alone could be a boon to that industry.
Interesting. Interesting. Thank you, by the way, for sharing that. I do appreciate that. So when it comes to businesses, right, so from your vantage point, what do you think are some of the challenges that you see businesses struggling with when they grapple around the fact that they need to be data-driven? What are some of the things that you could say that businesses are doing wrong or they could improve upon?
Have I said communication? you know, I guess, you know, this is probably one that you could stack up, right? What makes a good data scientist, a good data science team, you know, a good data-driven company? I think are a couple of things. You know, it really is communication, but this is hard since even in a small team, we're working with biases that are hidden from, you know, ourselves, even from each other. You know, we have some people that embrace change, you know, like it's the panacea. Well, you know, others are still reluctant to get involved. I remember working to convince people in the 90s that laptops really were a thing. They were going to carry them. They were going to need them. And so I think that the greatest challenge is to embrace the diversity of opinions. We use the phrase often in our teams about being aligned. Okay, so I can say, look, I'm absolutely aligned. I completely disagree with you, right? But I can align with you. We can move forward together because I do see the, you know, the prevailing, you know, agreements, beliefs of the team. And, you know, the joke with my, you know, working with me is that, you know, I'm a great guy to, you know, charge ahead. I'm, you know, I'm kicking the door, embrace change, you know. They joke because they'll do things like, Dan, you know, the door's unlocked. Actually, you know, love your enthusiasm, Dan, but so they're, you know, being in communication has saved a lot of wear and tear on me, you know. This challenge, you know, forgive me for using one swear word in my entire conversation, or I hope to be, but many smart people that I work with suffer from what I call damn fool's disease. They believe in the phrase, you know, any damn fool knows that, right? And that if they know it or they figured it out, it can't be that hard. And I think Dunning-Kruger is a great thing to go look up for those of you who want to see an interesting. The Dunning-Kruger effect is somewhat like this, but it's an ancillary to it. But people faced with Dunning-Kruger and faced with, you know, I think everybody knows it if I do, they don't speak up. They don't, you know, they assume, oh, well, somebody else must have already thought of this and discarded it for a reason. And I mean, if I can, one of the best fun projects I'm doing right now. There's a guy named Daryl Pyle he's at IBM, a longtime data scientist. And he, just to learn some things about AI, he decided to create, he was going to use visualization. He was going to get AI and Watson, it's IBM, to visualize, to be able to take pictures of and look at chemical signals, you know, the diamonds that have four colored diamonds in them. And what he wanted to do is basically be able to snap a picture of that with some sort of app and have that app go up into the cloud, get analyzed and come back, you know, here's what this stuff is. And so that's alone, he's working on that. And that's very interesting. Well, got together with a few of us to talk about it. And I've done a lot of disaster relief work and early work, you know, into disaster areas, Katrina, Quake of 89, things like that. And I looked at him and said, this is an amazing thing. He said, what? I said, well, imagine you take a picture of that. It goes up to Watson, gets, you know, we jokingly call it in response teams, methyl ethyl bad stuff, right? Some horrible chemicals in there. But because of this microservices architecture, he can grab his current geolocation and he can grab the weather. He can combine it with that. And now he has the three things that he can send to an emergency management agency that turn that from interesting, we know how bad the chemical is, to actually telling the guys that are about to roll up on that, can they use water? Do they have to use a chemical retardant? Is the weather, whether it be winds or rain, gonna create something? You know, and you know, this is, you know, I wouldn't necessarily call any of that outside of the box, but I would call it that diversity of people and that communication, you know, that are going together to create a great app. I think he's probably gonna, before he builds an app, he's probably just gonna use Twitter. He'll tweet it up to the cloud and the cloud will tweet back, you know, run fast and send this to the fire department. And, you know, just because, you know, we can play around with this stuff. So there's a huge amount of work available. You know, every time I think we're done with that or I can see the edge of IoT or the edge of AI, somebody comes up with something like that.
Interesting. And what are some of the things you're pleasantly surprised with when it comes to dealing with businesses? Like, did you say, hey, I never expected that you get it, but now you get it. So what are some of those things?
You know, actually, something that I fall prey to that disease I talked about, because it's a negative that still surprises me, which is, companies still fail to clearly understand their data sets. Now, we all talk, you know, people invest in a huge amount of money in the end game. I want great analytics. I want great, you know, charts. I want to be interactive with them. And that's terrific. And they don't look at what they're bringing in. And, you know, failure to understand data sets clearly or cleanse them. So, funny story. You mentioned voter registration. So I had what I considered to be a brilliant idea. I don't know if it's probably still true today, but in Chicago in the 80s, 18% of the city moved every month, right? I'm sorry, every year, 18% of the city changed their address. And that meant those people needed to have a phone number, right? Some sort of phone change. So I started comparing. So I went to a political campaign. We got the money to start comparing phone numbers to unregistered voters. So we'd find your name and phone number and we'd match it with a voter registration. If there was no match, well, you weren't registered to vote, right? So we'd call you. And it turned out we were calling a lot of deceased people because it's a habit back then when you had a landline that you never changed. The name on the phone. You know, your husband would pass away and you would, and I remember the team that was actually doing the live work coming to me and saying, look, Dan, we can't do this. We're getting all the things. Wow. You know, and it was my failure to understand the data set. So, you know, we solved it by closing in on new phone numbers, right? Figuring that if someone set up a new phone number, they definitely had moved, you know, they definitely had something. So it, you know, it's, That failure at multiple levels of, I guess if somebody came to me and said, you know, I'm setting up data science, who should I hire first? I'd say a data engineer, because you really want somebody like that looking at your data and looking at what it's going to take to cleanse it. You know, I start at the very beginning of the pipe, you know, because frankly, until you know what you have, you almost don't know the particularly subject matter specifics of the data scientist you might want to hire.
Interesting. So now let's spend some time on the role called data scientist, right? So what are, from your vantage point, what are some of the ingredients of a successful data scientist?
You know, I think when I guess I would probably go back to, well, two simple things for people because they can look them up very easily. What's proven out for me for years at, what was his name, Drew Conway. Drew Conway did a Venn diagram in 2010. And, you know, he talked about, and he used the language of developers more than anything else, and hacking skills, statistics skills, substantive expertise in some area. I tell you, by the way, to feel that substantive expertise is almost impossible to find with the rest of it. That's why data science teams are good. Unless you've got someone who's dedicated themselves to, you know, a particular market segment, to telecommunications or law or something like that, you need somebody else. But when a few years after Drew Conway came in, they added my favorite, communication. So the Venn diagram went, you know, from three circles to sort of four ovals. Mm. And there's a great data scientist Venn diagram out there that I think really describes, and, you know, as I look to recall things, you know, really described the need for statistical analysis, you know, the need for programming, the need for some business acumen. But I have to keep coming back to, the classes that data scientists should be taking, need to take, and the books that they should be reading and need to read are about communication. And not even, you know, sort of business communication, although it's certainly valuable, but just personal communication. And that's very tough on a lot of us who, you know, who come from, I mean, we come from a world where, frankly, everybody's suspicious of our ability to communicate. You know, if you're a developer, right, or a programmer, people are constantly surprised by how many developers are musicians, you know, how many of them are, you know, have fascinating outside, you know, bicyclists, you know, canyon climbers, all kinds of things. But training in how to communicate, whatever it is you've learned or you know, is, I think, grossly underestimated still in the world. And I mean, that's one of my, you know, big pushes today is evangelism everywhere, is that people have to be more than simply stating the facts. They have to be truly and so if somebody's looking, you know, what am I supposed to be learning next? For me, it's up your communication skills.
I think that's a fascinating thought, by the way. So I remember that I was working with one of the university when they were putting together a Masters of Data Analytics course, and I was discussing then, and they gave me this chart, and it has like, hey, do some R, do some sort of Python, do like all this stuff, and there was no sort of communication. And it was funny, so I was telling them, hey, what about if they can't communicate properly? And this is, say, and the funny thing was that right now they have 1/3 of the courses all about communication. So I think you're spot on that it's such a important piece of thing. And the other thing that I speak to a lot of in my either keynote addresses or when I'm talking to a bunch of grads coming out of the school is that data science is having a lot of trust issues nowadays. So when you talk about Brexit, when you talk about predicting US election, when you talk about almost every data pool has missed out on these massive, massive, massive prediction. And my rant was, hey, imagine if it's an economy, it can sustain some blow, but imagine GE going through such a mishap, imagine going IBM going through such a mishap, they won't stand another day if they can go such a berserk on their prediction. So data has, so I was telling them that data has a human problem nowadays, surprisingly. So like your future would be not about data anymore. It's about, and you're spot on that communication is, and I thank you so much for sort of emphasizing 800 times, as you said, about the communication as one of the core component.
You brought up a great point about it. And I think that it's, they're starting to teach it. And, you know, it's interesting, the trust issue. You know, two movies I watch chunks of a lot are Hidden Figures and Apollo 13. And both talk about failures and look at the, you know, the space program. You know, I mean, people died, rockets blew up, millions of dollars were lost as we ventured into a very new realm. And I think one of the problems is as we get into predictive analytics and particularly, you know, ML, DL kinds of things, you know, machine learning, deep learning that are, you know, helping us do this sort of stuff and data scientists that are grappling with it, we're in a new area. People, I think laymen in the world think, oh, well, you're doing something different with a computer. Well, yeah, and we were just doing something different with, you know, engines and gravity with rockets. I mean, in the end, we were just trying to push harder than we ever had before. You know, the math is the, you know, pretty similar. And I think that we need to look at why those happen. Darkest Hour, the Churchill movie that just came out. When you talk about data, there's a scene in there, and I have no idea if it's apocryphal or not, but it's wonderful because Churchill decides to ride the tube, right? The London subway. And it changes his mind about what the people want. And he goes forward secure that, you know, absolutely sure that what he's doing is right. And I think the problems of from data science, certainly in the last presidential, was that we had become enamored to looking at the numbers. You know, both sides, the we, the royal we of data science, you know, and I think that we, they lost that human part. They lost somehow, you know, what are people, you know, saying, feeling? We did this in jury selection. Here's an interesting, just a quick side on that one for the human part. You often can't ask people questions about themselves when you're selecting a jury. There are certain questions that, unless they're directly related to the case at hand, you can't ask them. So it's sort of like doing churn analysis, but you can't ask them about products. Right. So one of the questions that someone came up with, and this was out of the blue, this was actually one of the administrative staff who was working on the project. Heard people talking, was sitting in on a meeting because, you know, they were a valuable input, even though zero classical training in any of this. They said, why don't we ask people what kind of bumper stickers they have on their cars? Right? So there you are under oath, right? So you can't really, so you say, well, I've got, and that can, you find things. And first of all, if you're, if you are, you know, if you feel enough that you're going to put it on there, right, that's something real. So it could be a sticker. It could be a religious sticker. It could be something about, you know, pets or family or whatever. And I don't think there was any of that, you know, in the data science that went into elections. You know, there was no, but is anybody talking to people? You know, anybody actually, you know, trying to find out why? Which is why great marketing, you know, takes all that scientific data and then still has somebody come out. I had a great random event happen to me. I was part of a cheese study. Just, I mean, my wife signed us up and a guy from it turned out to be from Kraft, came and had dinner with us and went shopping with us. We talked about cheese. You know, and I, you know, I think I'm interested in it, but we don't do that enough in science. You know, even
I think it's I think it's fascinating. So I think it reminds me of I was sitting with the chief data officer at one of the apparel company, and they make shoes. They make high end sport shoes. And sort of and I said and he said you want to go on a walk with me? I said yeah, let's go. And he took me to a soccer field. And he was just seeing kids playing with the shoe. And he said, this keeps me grounded. this keeps me understand that no, data has a human element in it, right? So he said that many times when I'm looking at data, I don't understand that there's the real people behind it.
Mm-hmm.
And that gives me sort of gravity. Sure, I have my own biases, but yes, how I can sort of create a platform that can have a lot of voices. That was like, it's a beautiful thing. So I wrote a letter to the CEO that just give him a raise. There are very few folks who are like this. So
it's interesting because where I saw that most in action, although was the military, although many people would disagree, but when you're risking what you're risking, particularly, I mean, I was basically a paratrooper foot soldier out there. If I don't have use for something, I will I'll toss it. And I think your story is it's exactly the same sort of thing, right? He's looking at what these kids are doing with these shoes, and he's got to think about things like, are they stable enough to provide safety? Mm. Are they wicking away the right amount of moisture? Are they able to deal with whatever they want to deal with? It's absolutely. I'm going to steal that story.
it's fascinating. So. I think we're almost tearing off our conversation. And Dan, thank you so much for being very, really candid and open. We are at the last end, and I want to talk briefly about you too. Like, in your journey, what are some of the things that has helped you stay sane and successful? If you can share some of those insights for our listeners and viewers.
I guess very few of these. I mean, constant learning.
Hmm.
Not even so much because I learn something, because it makes me aware that I need the people around me. I mean, I guess I that's really. They all evolve around, of course, communication, right? In the sense that I go look at the world and I get, the world, that you, I mean, as much as you track and talk to people and talk about it, do the same, at some level, I don't know anything. Mm. I mean, in the whole world of technology, someone once asked me if they thought I'd ever be a big fish at IBM. And I said, no, I don't think so, because the big fish at IBM do things like send calls. So I think that knowing that is humbling, and keeping a team around me that, so when I go look at something and say, well, I know nothing about that, I've got someone I can go talk to, give me a piece of that, who can help get that started. And look for things that I haven't seen. On my bird call project, which for many of your listeners will they'll realize it's very much like the Shazam app. You hold your phone up to the radio, and it tells you the song. Except it's infinitely more complex because the audio's out in the real world. It never occurred to me to go onto GitHub and. Somebody said, well, there's a project. There's a, there's some folks out there. It's like, holy cow.
Wow.
And they're doing it completely differently than I am. So I'm excited to reach out to them and have something. So I guess the things that have really grounded me and kept me going are, that I constantly get humbled by my data, by my team, by my lack of knowledge of something new. And so I keep around me people who know how to communicate and share.
Interesting.
Keep me going forward.
Awesome. And one thing also I ask all of our guests is to share one of their favorite read or reads with our listeners.
Well,
would you have something for us?
For fun lately, I've been churning through a lot of science fiction. But again, in the world, the two books that would come to mind. I mean, really well. There's an author, and I'm going to murder his last name. I think it's Patrick Lencioni. The first book he wrote was called The Five Temptations of a CEO. And it's a 1 hour, maybe 90 minute read. It's actually written as a fable about a startup in San Francisco. You could read his whole set. I think his first is best. But understanding how people think, particularly at senior levels, you know, when you deal with that, I think is vital. The other one's probably pretty far off the wall, but there's a guy named Joe Navarro who wrote a book called What Everybody Is Saying. He's an FBI agent who works, you know, who talks about reading body language. And he's very clear about what doesn't work and what's theoretical and you know, what you can count on. The reason I'm looking at that is because one of the frontiers of AI that's being explored is when you get to the human interchange, right, interaction, how much have you expressed to me in this video or I expressed to you by that, you know, you know, or kinds of looks, right, that will, you know, that are going to be the dead giveaway. I mean, you know, great, Google passed a Turing test. You know, Google's never going to pass a smile test with that. You know, you and I aren't going to, you know, aren't going to buy into that for a long time. And I'm, you know, looking at what Joe Navarro's doing, reading about understanding how people react, I think ultimately is going to make for better AI, even as cognitive assistants. You know, they're going to want to interact on a level that impacts you deeper than just the numbers they give you.
Interesting. And last but not the least, so if you want the audience to take away something from this conversation, like what would that be? What would be your parting thought to our listeners and viewers?
You know, this is a question you've asked me. Well, you've asked me a question a couple of different ways. And I guess if it was the last thing, I'd say, you know what? Don't be afraid, regardless of whether you're 2 years or 20 years into this business, don't be afraid to take projects and positions that are tangential to what you say your goals are. You know, if they interest you, take them. In the long run, I haven't found a single past position, a single past project that I could not draw a story or an idea or even a solution from. You know, so, you know, don't be afraid in this blossoming world to zigzag a little, you know, to not count on, to try things even if you don't have the right degree, if you don't have the right specialty, right? But if you have something that's going to, you know, make a difference, you believe, apply for it. If they give it to you, absolutely take it. In the long run, it's never steered me wrong.
Beautiful. With that, Dan, again, thank you so, so much for, again, sitting very candidly and walking us through your journey, walking us through some of the pitfalls in the industry that's happening. That was really, really goldmine for all of our listeners and viewers. And you're always welcome back on the show to share your journey. And I think we haven't covered enough ground. Like, I don't know if listeners and viewers can see. Like, we have figured out a bunch of questions that we'll go through. I have not even barely started on that. So we had a lot of interesting conversations. So with that, then, thank you so much, and thank you.
Well, you're welcome, and thank you. I appreciate the opportunity. It was a lot of fun, and it took me in new directions. It forced me to think about, well, why do I feel that way? So that's again, that's the learning. You know, I want to talk to somebody who challenges me as often as I can, and I appreciate the challenge you presented. Thank you.
Thank you.
I thought I was sick of home, but actually I was homesick. Never really knew that I would have to grow up so quick. I'm so uncomfortable, don't know anybody here. Just a couple dudes that I met once, that's it. And I go into the booth feeling nervous. Got butterflies in my stomach like I'm so worthless. Is the mic on? I don't know how to work this. Inside I'm breaking down, I hope I'm not up on a circuit.